had some response you're getting here.
It is.
I mean, the whole weekend has been like this. Hey, guys, tell you what, if you have a question, put up your hand right away, because we're not going to remember at the end, and you're not going to remember the question. So it's going to be always. So if you have a question, put up your hand right away. So, what do you think of this crowd this year?
I think it's marvelous.
And you know what? It's your 50th anniversary.
Oh, it is.
Think about it. 1969 to 2009, the 50th anniversary of the Super Bowl.
I haven't had this suit down in 25 years.
Still fits.
It still does. But it amazes me that people still are.
Oh, wait.
I've had an awful year now, 25 years.
Well, let me just point something out, folks. Marty and I did some TV appearances for Marty, obviously, on Friday. And we got out of the car. Seconds later, a security guard. It's Superhost! And the thing was, he had his, your raincoat, yeah, well, over the suit.
Recognized by the
flash or raincoat.
Not flash.
So I can go between appearances.
There you go. This is a Comicon, obviously, and you were inspired by comic books.
I was indeed. I grew up with the stack of comic books in the garage, you know, and you take them and trade them with your neighbor. I got two Batmans, well, I'll give you a Superman.
That would be good. Yeah. Little thinking that years later you'd be wearing the red coat right
now. Yep, exactly. I think that's part of the inspiration for it.
Terrific. Hey, the early days of TV, keep this in mind. When Marty got into TV, it was only in Cleveland for about, 20 some years, I think. So, right. So you were really a pioneer. You were one of the pioneers.
That's right. We were the very first UHF station in Cleveland. And we were actually licensed in Lorraine, but there were some political connections and corrections in there. Wound up with the station and farm.
Were there any rules?
But there were rules, but we weren't obeyed them.
Oh, okay. Well, the greatest thing about people back then, and you know, obviously this is Marty's a great example, you didn't have a lot of special effects, you didn't have a lot of technology, and people tuned in because of talent. I mean, did you know what you were going to do when you went off the interview? Did you have a plan?
No, I didn't.
Really?
The whole show was
amazing, really.
For 20 years. Yeah. I'm
exhausted. Well, you know what? You and among the other greats, a lot of people say that. Well, Lynn Sheldon, you were Lynn Sheldon. He had lived everything.
Oh, he did. He was remarkable. And he had the ability to tell an off-color story in any condition amongst ladies and everything, and he got away with it. like Buddy Hackett, remember him?
Oh,
he
was
telling off color stories, but he had a way of telling it that nobody minded.
Amazing. When Superhost, when you first proposed Superhost, was it a tough sell?
No. I had been in the studio doing something, and somebody thought my fly was over, told me my fly was over. So I was trying to correct that and be on camera, and the station or the program manager asked me to come up with an idea for a movie, Holes to Carry. And this is the idea I came up with. And they simply said, well, do a pilot show, a sample, and if we like it, go put it on the air.
And was that easy?
Was that simple? Yeah.
Well, I mean, when did you do you did it after hours.
Oh, yeah, the station signed off at midnight. So we came in, a bunch of friends and I, into the studio, and we came to put out the show, and they presented to management. They bought it.
There you go. Well, wait a minute, you also put the names of management.
Oh, I did, yes. So they were on the titles and credits.
Henry Bernstein.
Super Boss. Henry Bernstein. We had three directors. Henry Graves, Bert Spektorsky, and I meshed the names all together and came up with a character named Henry Burkerstein, who was the meek, mild-mannered TV director who changed into Superhost when he went into the booth, the phone booth, and uttered the magic words, sponsor.
Hey, now that phone booth, There's a legend. I don't know if you can verify this. Somebody stole that phone booth.
Yes, somebody did steal that.
Did you catch it?
Performer.
A perfidious, but who was that performer?
That performer was Big Chuck.
He stole my phone booth, literally.
They were over at the station taping a commercial or something. And we talked, chatted for a bit, and I had to go about my announcing duties. And then they finished their commercial and took my phone and went.
That must have been an inside job, though.
That must have been.
But you know what? Was that the same phone booth that, because you made an appearance on Big Chuck's show.
I did.
Yeah, now how did that come about?
Well, that was, well, we talked all the time, we were good friends, and he said he wanted to get through a little something, so I went out to Big Chuck's show.
Come on.
The phone booth, that phone booth, was out on the street corner.
You know, the funny thing about the phone booth, I was with a group that put on an exhibit at the Peter Public Library. It was about Superman. All these wonderful artifacts. We had original costumes, original art, wonderful things. You know, things, Jerry Siegel's yearbook, stuff like that. There was one thing that everybody took a picture of. In fact, there were long lines, and they didn't know what it was. And we actually had to put up a little like sign explaining what a phone booth was. And they had proms and things like that. And people were taking their pictures at the phone booth. If that phone booth was in your house today, it'd be worth a lot of money.
Probably would.
I'd be sure. It wasn't good, folks. If you do have a question for Marty, please. And we have him right here.
Do you still have the blonde wig?
The blonde wig?
No, I don't. That belonged to my, the guy that did the switch on station, Chuck McLean. His wife bought that something, a Halloween costume or something. And she donated that to Sue. The moronic woman. And we filmed that bit up behind the studios where they were in the pond. It was all woods back there. And we just went back in the woods and filmed a dainty, super moronic woman running out of the
room. Wait, but I have a question here.
Yeah, just kind of following up on the moronic woman. You kicked the, try to feel ball in your leg.
Okay, went over that.
Alright, you said you filmed that, behind the woods, and I was just curious to know, was that behind, was it always supposed to be that way? Because my grandparents lived behind Valley Forge High.
Was that Valley Forge?
Fast, it looked just like that, and I was wondering if that's the
And that one that was kicked in, there was one scene where the football went flying over the thing. But one of the chaps at the station happened to be a tryout for the, I think it was the, some football team in, which football team, it was down in Texas somewhere. He's the one that kicked that, and he kept kicking a mile.
Hey, you know what, I think you also, you mentioned once before, you took some of the ideas for some of your skits from other people. I mean, if they offered you a skit idea, you said, well, let's work with it.
I'm sure, yeah. The moronic woman, if you remember that one. There was one episode where she was trying to stop a thief in a car from driving away with all the loot from the bank. And she came up and grabbed the phone in her arms. But I found dryer hose and painted it blue so it matched the suit. And that's what happened with the dryer hose.
Yeah, the thing that always got me too was how many families on a Saturday afternoon would put aside time to watch Superhost. I mean, it was like must see TV in the middle of the day. Show of hands, you know? Look at this. There you go. But I mean, was it always meant to be like that? What, a family show, or was it just a
family show? I thought at the beginning, I wasn't going to do any junk humor, like, you know,
yeah,
double on others and stuff. Sure. I figured it would keep the kids on the watch.
Yeah. And you know, how many people, I mean, did they recognize you outside the Superhost suit?
Oh, sure.
Did it really?
Yeah, when I go into restaurants and stuff, it's like, are you that guy with the TV? Yeah. How about that? Something for my cousin, too.
I remember once we were in a restaurant, Al Roker walked in and somebody said, hey Al, what's the weather like? He said, stick your head out the window. But he did it in such a nice way, you know, you can get around with that. So, any other questions here? Because we have a great, great opportunity.
You used to get like weekly, every Saturday you would get artwork from kids.
Oh yeah.
How much of that did you actually get? I always wondered that.
Oh, you know, show us. We got tons of it.
Did you?
When you saw those pictures in the pan, you know, all the crayons and stuff. They had lots of them there. Sometimes, when we didn't have so many,
But still, yeah, you know, that, I mean, that was a great old tradition, too, from kids' TV. Send in the pictures, and, you know, automatically the kids would be there, and, you know, they'd go on, just before VCRs.
Right.
So you got to take your word for it that the picture was there. But, Mom, did you ever send a picture?
No, I didn't. But I told a story to him about how I really liked the movie Horror Hotel.
Oh,
so really? So when he ran it, he rented his Witch Hotel. Uh-huh. VCRs came out, and I think we all went to buy it. So I went to actually go buy it, and I couldn't find it anywhere.
Nuts.
Oh. And I called a guy because it's Mr. Cinema, and he explained to me that with the television stations, five of his movies, they would hide them, and then he had to have a Witch Hotel. And that was a trick he did.
I'm glad you brought that up, too, because, you know, Marty and I were at Channel 19 on Friday. They did a segment with Marty for 19 and Channel 43. But I just want to mention, on Friday, this Friday, set your VCRs. Set your digital recorder. You're going to be on Crimson Cleveland again with Josh Maria. It's a great piece. You got to see it to believe it. You'll be sorry if you don't have the recording of it. And then live on Lakeside at 3, and there's kind of a reference to the drawings that you're really going to get a kick out of. So we're going to have Marty here for another week, whether he goes home or not. I saw the handbook, yeah.
Any truth to the rumors that when you would go from taking the Superhost show to reading the news, you have the soup outfit on below the desk?
Yes, very possible. I actually had a photograph somewhere of that. I got to wash off the nose, put the shirt on, the tie on, the coat on, and tie this stuff under the coat and shirt. And then I walked through the news.
Well, that's, you know, that was the thing, too, because everybody knew you from Superhost, but they also knew your voice from voiceovers. And,
I think that was possible for some small fry.
And then people hear your voice. You had a question.
First of all, thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here.
Sure.
A dream, wonderful. So you just hit a certain kid. The right way, right? And probably everybody in this room was that kid who Saturday morning we could just spend 4 hours with you and, please tell them. There's one episode that I remember specifically that stood out to me as being odd. There was an episode where, you guys will tell me if I'm crazy, you like took a blackboard and explained Reaganomics.
Yeah,
you had a trickle-down economics lesson during
Superhost. Wow. Yeah, that was soup civics.
That's amazing. And I mean, was it like for a kid? I mean, you know,
it completely went over my head.
Oh, sorry.
I had no idea what he was talking about, but it was funny. Because it was soup, and, we went out of Three Stooges into soup civics, and he was at a blackboard kind of drawing stuff on the blackboard and explaining trickle-down economics, and I was like, okay, whatever, soup civics.
That's funny. Years ago, a guy told me, he said, think about this. He said, Superhost, Captain Penny, Barnaby, Woodrow the Woodsman. He said, they were, even though there was a generation gap in the 60s, we loved all the kid shows, the 60s and 70s. Well, why? Because they wore different kind of clothes. They preach peace and love. They preach family. Let's all get together. And they, sort of like hippie values, just aiming themselves toward, that generation. Where it was like, really, you guys were like a generation bridge rather than a gap. That was the greatest thing. You mentioned Three Stooges, though.
Oh, for sure.
There was a lot of controversy when they first came on the air. Did you still have that controversy by the time you were on your show? They didn't think it was for kids. Was there still that kind of...
No, I didn't hear any controversy. The only controversy I recall was there was two Moes or two Larrys.
Oh, right.
Two Curlys. Curlys. Sorry about that. And that's all I remember.
Oh, okay.
It was two Curlys.
Well, that was, early on, there was... Keeping in mind when it was they were on the Captain Penny show, there was a great for you and cry, this is not for kids. Mm-hmm. And all Captain Penny had to say was, kids, don't poke your brother's eyes, okay? Don't do that. It's really just, a joke and all that sort of thing. And they would always tell you to calm down. It didn't calm me down.
That might be better nowadays, but you know darn well that song's not good.
Yes, for sure. Any other questions, sir? In the back.
Did you guys ever get any flack for using the convoy music in your skit?
No, I never did. And the Boxcar Willie, what's his name again?
Sullivan or
Boxcar?
Oh, it was Boxcar Willie.
When we did the takeoff on Boxcar, he actually got wind of it somewhere, and he sent a letter saying how much he liked it. That's very much your doing.
You know, the funny thing was yesterday, a guy came by, not that young, but he came by and said, "Gotta meet Marty Sullivan." He said, "I actually play a role in Marty's history." How? He said, "Those were my trucks. My dad bought in my trucks for the convoys. Those were my toys."
Yet to a church. His father was the great balloonologist.
Oh, no.
Small animals out of balloons.
You know, before we go to the other questions, I wanted to ask you, you were on a hee-haw once.
I was, yes.
Which was kind of odd.
In Cornfield. Buck Owens.
Roy Clark.
Roy Clark.
Why do I know this?
You got a great memory.
But Sal, how did that come about?
That came about because the show was aired on 43. So they had a thing where they brought people from local markets to their show and taped them and then put them together in the hee-haw shows. I happened to be one of them in the cornfield with Clark and Roy. And that was amazing too, going to lunch on one of the days down there for the taping. We all went to a truck stop down there by Tennessee somewhere, near Nashville, probably in Nashville. But the people that went with us, like Graham Jones and
Lulu was probably
Lulu was big. The one who went to the truck stop, everybody just forgot about the rest of us, and it was all comedy stars. And they were just adored by those people. They couldn't do anything wrong, and they got top drawer service and all that stuff. It was great to see them. They loved the hee-haw people. As a matter of fact, when I moved to Oregon, my neighbor was a fan of the hee-haw when it was off the air. And he thought he'd give me a pair of coveralls that he knew all over. I gave this to this guy who drove a log truck. And he's got the hee-haw overalls up in his living room.
Well, you're lucky it was hee-haw, not professional wrestling. Those guys are tough.
Oh, yeah.
I saw their hands go up.
The movies that you played, did you pick any of them, or did
they tell you? I didn't think the management picked them all. That's why they're so bad.
Well, you know, the funny thing was, Ernie Anderson said that they used to have a wonderful, you'd get the A films, the B films, and the C films. When are we going to run these C films? Overnight, nobody watches.
Right.
So next thing you know, you're going to go to host, everybody's watching it. So these films probably got more audience on your show than the theaters there.
How many of you remember Starman?
Oh, yes.
I thought it was so funny. A little Japanese guy with a cape that came to here.
Yeah.
And he got into a big fight scene and kicked one of the villains upstairs.
I mean, the greatest thing was, so many of those films are revered now. You know, you go to some of the conventions, and they have like the C-movie list there, and that's where the crowd is. Everybody looking for those old movies, and they love when they were kids there and stuff. The only thing missing is Superhost.
Right.
Were there any whole shows taped back then? Because you went off in 1989.
No, we just did the wraps.
Oh, okay.
And the other tapes were thrown back into the bin and recorded over.
Isn't that amazing? Gosh. That's just amazing. You know, the funny thing was, and that's the way everybody was very budget conscious, obviously. Barbara Streisand actually did, she was the co-host with Mike Douglas for a whole week in Cleveland. Yeah. And they taped it, and they were outraged. They came down and they talked to the producers there, KYW, and said, "Who authorized $1,500 for the week for Barbara Streisand?" They were so outraged, they said, "Take those tapes, we have to record public service announcements on them." It'd be worth millions today. Well, think what your stuff would be worth today on the interview. Oh my gosh. And well, actually, I think every now and then, I think Channel 43 still has some of your stuff in an archive there.
Yes, they did save the wraparounds, but not the whole show.
I'm going to ask you
some of the wraparounds.
I remember 1989, and you said, just out of nowhere, you said, hey, we got a big announcement next week. And tell us about that.
Well, the big announcement was that was the last show. After that, something else was on set. I don't know what.
But I mean, I remember I tuned in and said, what's the big announcement? And I said, well, this is the last show. And they said, hey, I got to leave. You turned out the lights in the morning.
That's right. Right? Went out, grabbed a cab, and took off.
Krypton, yes. That was it. That was it. I mean, the craziest thing was, and I mean, at that time, I'm in my 30s, I thought, oh, no, this is terrible. This is a loss for me. And I remember getting on the phone with somebody and saying, did you hear Superhost is off the air? And it was like, you know, just the shockwaves, you know, that this happened. So I'm surprised, though, that that happened. Did they just have, like, a paid program or something, or did you just decide?
Well, it was kind of mutual. I talked to the program manager earlier and said, I'd rather you kill Super off quick than stretch it out over a long time with the ratings dying. By the way, one person watching, so that's what he did. He made the decision that the ratings were down.
Really? So he did. You wore so many hats around that station.
Oh, yeah. Everybody at the station did multiple jobs because it was just getting started and managing the hidden player. So you were able to be a cameraman, an announcer, a floor director, whatever you had to do, sweep floors, whatever.
Well, that's Bruce Spectorsky. He became the general manager at Channel 3, I think also at Channel 43.
Yes.
He started out basically doing that. He was an intern, then he was a cameraman.
And while he was doing all those jobs, he was taking a mass comm course at down at Kent State.
Is that right?
Yeah.
That's amazing. Folks, remember, hands up if you have a question.
So, what was the inspiration for your catchphrases that you would say all the time? Like, give me that shoe, and hello there, and...
Well, give me that shoe, you guys. That's the catchphrase. Because that was in the open, you remember, where there was a crowd scene, and one guy standing there with his hand up, and it's a street corner scene, so... He says, look in the sky, it's a bird. No, it's a plane, no, it's what's... And then he came down with a shoe, and I reached and grabbed the shoe and said, give me that shoe. For some reason, everybody liked that.
I noticed the guy brought a high-top shoe for you to autograph yesterday.
Yes, it did. These are the original silk shoes, sir. Yeah.
They should be in a museum, not on your feet.
I bought them at Sears for $7.99.
Yeah, no kidding. It's funny you mentioned that.
Yeah, the one you bought, wasn't it?
Oh my gosh, I bought them on sale for $55. And I bought the shoe to bring to Channel 3, and my wife told me, bring back that shoe, just like that. Because otherwise, you know, I just paid, you know, 55 bucks for one shoe. But that was one thing, you know, nice to see it, Josh Gibson. Yeah, I said to me, the phone booth, though, that stayed at Channel 43 for a long time. It was almost like, you know, just sitting there.
Right.
And, I mean, think about it. You go into a TV station. What's the phone booth doing over there?
Yeah, in the back, we had round studios, and there was big double doors that went out into the access room where the carpenter shop was and stuff. And that's where the phone booth stayed, where all the other scenery flats had been put up. Just stuck, keep them out of the studio. There was, until Big Chuck came along.
Well, I think a guy named Jerry Jaswell wrote into his truck, too. Jerry was, and you know, to show you just how TV progresses, Jerry retired and his son took over for where it was. So there's going to be somebody with that last name doing that same job for many years to come.
Yeah, Jerry was a carpenter and general fixer and anything both in station, he fixed. Great. Yet apparently, he worked for the city of Parma before that. I don't know. Probably was doing there, probably the same thing. But then his son took over doing the same job. It's amazing.
You know, you saw the response that you got this week.
Yeah.
And the anticipation of you coming in for this was just sky high. Are you surprised that, like, popular culture, the way it's just progressed up to this point, that it's so important to everybody?
I am surprised. I didn't think anybody would remember after a couple of years and just forget about so
grandchildren were born. And I'm always wondering, because I met his grandchildren, and they said, yeah, we know our grandfather was somebody pretty important up in Cleveland. How do you think, how would you describe soup to somebody? How would you want somebody to describe Superhost?
Oh, geez, this guy in the super suit that appeared on TV, and we watched movies on set.
I think it's a lot more than that. I think it's a lot more than that. How would you guys describe Superhost?
He's everybody's best friend.
That's, once again, you should be up there. Terrific. Everybody's best friend on Saturday.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. We'll take a guess.
Shape my taste in I like all kinds of movies. I like real good classic movies and everything. The way he shaped my taste in movies that I probably never would have seen anywhere else. And even to this day, I mean, you know, I'll sit down with my daughter and watch Godzilla, or I'll go throw in a hammer film and watch it with my sons. And it's because that's where I first saw it. Saturday afternoon when I wasn't outside playing.
Mike's gonna play.
Well, I don't watch it. Association with monsters is because of the Northeast Ohio TV hosts.
Yeah.
The Army, which I can see, the super host, and so on. And,
Sound cool.
That's funny. Kevin, where's Kevin?
Well, you know, it's funny that Mike brought that up because Joe Bob Briggs one day, when he had Ernie Anderson on, he said, you know what? I wasn't like a lot of kids. I wanted to grow up in Cleveland, Ohio. And why? Because you had such great hosts here and stuff. You got to interact with a lot of them, right?
I did, yeah. I was influenced greatly by the large home. As a matter of fact, I was working in radio on a Saturday night, so I watched the larger because I loved what he did with the movies. He did them with absolutely no respect. I remember one scene, that was a scene in a movie where the character was drinking water from a stream or something. That's just one of the scenes. And Ernie pops in with, well, it looks like ketchup. Or some commercial tagline. And he ended up that he would just appear in some parts of the movie for no apparent reason.
Did you do walk-ins as well? Because I
know I didn't break.
Yeah. But you know, that was, some of those movies were begging for that.
Oh yeah. There was one, when I first went on the air with the show, and it was a long time, 5 hours, I think it was.
Oh, yeah, sure.
We were showing Little Shop of Horrors, if you may remember.
Oh, yeah.
And so we had a power measure and transmitter shutting off the air, so I put it on the air. So when we did come back on the air, I promised them I'd show them the movie the next week. Well, the boss had already scheduled the regular movie for the next week, so I started to run Little Shop of Horrors because I promised. So I went to the film department and got what they call a moviola, which is the edit machine to edit real fast on the film that was running through. And I ran the movie on that, really double speed or triple speed or whatever, and a lot of Mickey Mouse noises. And so I did. I ran it. No one can watch it.
Well, you had to worry about that before picture in picture. Because I'm going to ask you an unfair question. And whenever I've asked people, they always say, you know, I'll say, what was your favorite skit? I'll say, what's my favorite kid? I don't know. Do you have a favorite skit that you did?
I think Convoy was
probably. That got a lot of, really, that's a lot. Yeah.
I came in the other day, and he was the one who stole his truck. Dad, he stole his truck, so he set up his little Tonkas.
And the great thing about that was, if you want to go back with your cardboard, that was like Convoy. I mean, it was a cheap thing, but you got the point across. That was a great talent space. I saw for him. I'm sorry. Yeah, go ahead.
Have you ever thought about doing one last episode?
One last episode.
So never thought of it.
I mean, with technology, with Facebook and stuff.
Sorry.
The technology with like Facebook, you know, or whatever, you know, you could possibly do an episode, one last one.
I think you should.
Love to see it.
Well, that's a great point, you know. You come up with some great conversation. If it was on DVD, people would buy it.
Yeah.
I think so. Any other answer? You know what? So many people have come up. every week. You were like a member of the family.
Yeah.
And they come up, and sometimes, you know, you're hearing some of the conversations. It's almost like, my son, my brother, and things like that.
Yeah.
Were you getting the way back like that, you know, when Superhost was on the air?
Well, when I went to a public affair or a fair or something, I went to a fair quite a bit. And in Oktoberfest.
Oh, sure, yeah. What were the events like? What were the special? I mean, when you did personal appearances?
They were pretty heavy.
Yeah.
Because
I can see
there were a lot of people around that was trying to react with the people and sign autographs and talk to the kids and that kind of stuff. And the crew was after me, you know, doing the next segment.
Yeah, sure.
So it was kind of troubles.
Well, that brings up the next question. I mean, the studio audience. Did you ever think about having a studio audience?
No, a couple times I did where we had some scouts or something.
Yeah.
And then something got mad at me because the boss wouldn't allow too many of them because of firewalls and whatnot.
And that was a very relatively small studio. You had a lot of tables and things like that.
Yeah,
sure.
And they had a crowd of kids in there, even around what they're going to do.
Yeah. Well, that's true, too. Yeah.
It is kind of. I guess the insurance, something about the insurance, they had to be covered by the company insurance, and I raised the rates someday.
So you were a serious newsman,
right?
And you went to, well, I mean, you still had a serious job and stuff, but was it tough going from the serious news guy on WGAR to TV and Superhost?
Well, tough in the sense just changing costumes.
Oh.
I had to clean the nose off and put the Super Bowl down.
Prior to this opportunity, did you think, you know, I'd like to do this, like, you know, like years before or something?
I never thought about being a movie host. I wanted to be a newsman. I thought that was the A phase.
Yeah, sure.
It wasn't. As a matter of fact, when I tried to get into the news business, the television, they told me I was too young.
Yeah, right.
That's
exactly it. Well, I'm just curious about it because you had covered like a lot of serious stuff. You covered riots in Cleveland,
yeah.
You know.
I covered the Lakeview Saywell riot.
Really?
That was they were trying to build a new school in a racially sensitive neighborhood, and they didn't want it there. So they protested and people protesting.
Yeah.
The Reverend Bruce Plunder was killed there in an accident. Shot. They were bulldozers, kids driving bulldozers for the summer. Were putting in the foundation gate or something. And these people threw themselves in front of the bulldozer to stop it, demonstrating. And the Reverend Bruce threw himself in behind this one bulldozer, and the kid threw it in reverse. That was the end of the Reverend Bruce Plunder. It was tragic.
My father told me about that. He always referred to it as Plunder's Plunder.
Brother. I ask you though, I mean, you cover a lot of serious news and stuff. Why did you decide to go to TV? Was it just because you wanted to become a TV reporter?
Yeah, well, when I went to announcing school and all that, I wanted to be an announcer, and then I became an announcer. And then my further ambition was to get into TV. WJR Detroit, one of the announcers was Ray Engel. He was a newsman in there, and he left WJR to go to Cleveland. WGAR, obviously, and Charlie Hay, who was leaving to go to New York. So George called me up and asked me if I wanted to be a newsman, and I said, sure. So I got in the car and drove.
was that easy?
It was that easy. Oh,
what
my friend called.
Well, I mean, still, I mean, did you have any kind of news background? Like, did you do newspapers or something?
No, but in those days, all they had to do was radio news.
Well, that's true, too.
Yeah.
Well, then radio was a whole different animal back then.
Oh, yeah.
It was wonderful.
Well, WJR was one of the first stations in the country. And they had their own orchestra. The announcers had to wear tuxedos to work.
Oh. And
this radio, why would they have to wear tuxedos to work? Dumb.
Well, those were the days too, but I mean, I think that the engineers used to actually have to be dressed up too.
Oh, yeah, engineers. They had a remote radio too that they sent all the way to California and they even Clear Channel Station. They went to see California.
Really?
Yeah. Oh. At certain times they could pick them up.
That's some reach there.
Maybe I missed it, but when you did the show on every Saturday, was it live or was it taped?
It was taped.
Okay.
They call it live on tape. In other words, we taped it Friday night usually.
Okay.
And then the tape was run on Saturday with the morning in between.
Okay.
Live on tape, so we can answer a lot of the jumbo shrimp, peacekeeper missile things. Yes, go ahead.
Did you ever actually have to watch all the movies or did you just know about them?
I used to go in the back in the editing room where the film was edited, and I'd edit, look at it past because a lot of scenes were dull with just the film. I'd put it on the movie over and zip through it.
See, any other questions, folks? I'll tell you what, Marty wants to talk to all of you. You know, once again, the autographs are at the table. But we do have a special presentation. Go to the ask Mike to come up here, Mike's again. Ben and Bob, are you coming up here as well?
Yeah.
Come on up here. Guys, these are the guys. What have Mike and Bob brought? This, the event you had today started with the brains of these two guys. I think they're great.